Thank you for having me. I really appreciate the invitation and excited to share some of the work that I've done over the last couple of years and that's ongoing. And most of all the work I'm going to talk about today has been in David Raleigh's lab, who's at UCSF, and we'll go from there. So I wanted to start by just a quick background for people in the audience about the, it went fast. Anyway, meningioma is the most common primary brain tumor. It's more common in women. It's also more common in Blacks, and in particular in Blacks, more common to have malignant meningiomas. They typically present with headaches or cognitive changes if for large supratentorial lesions or seizures. For the one lesions along the skull base, the more commonly they'll present with a focal neurological deficit from compression. And with increasing imaging for trauma and other things, we're finding incidental meningiomas fairly commonly.
Far worse than what you're being told. We're not out of the woods.
The meningiomas are graded, grade one, which is the vast majority, up to 80%, which have an excellent long-term survival with treatment, 80 to 90% over 10 years, even progression-free survival. But the 20 to 30% that are atypicals and the much more rare WHO grade three anaplastic meningiomas have far shorter survival and progression-free survival down on the order of 25% at 10 years. And for grade three, no, they all progress within 10 years. The standard of care treatments, which provide excellent care and make treating these patients so much fun because they do well, for the most part, does very well. So recurrence-free survival, grade one or benign meningiomas at 10 years, 80%, atypical, a little shorter, 5 years, maybe 50%, and then the anaplastics are much worse. But they're patients we care for a long time. We know that surgery is very effective for meningiomas and that how the surgeon does doing good surgery matters. Gross total resection has a much lower rate of local recurrence compared to subtotal resection. So being able to get all the tumor is important. But when we can't, we have radiosurgery. So this is a study of 5,300 meningiomas that were treated with grade one meningiomas treated with radiosurgery. And at 10 years, over 80% are controlled. And at 5 years, it's over 95%. And that's consistent with our data from UCSF, where grade one, 5 year freedom from progression is over 90% or around 90% on imaging defined and in grade one meningiomas, but much lower for these grade twos and threes. So in one of the more recent kind of what's the state of meningiomas, the one of the first sentences in the results is the majority of meningiomas are benign. And so treating them with surgery and radiosurgery is an excellent option. But what the question that comes up then is what do we do for these more aggressive tumors? What do we do for the grade twos and threes that are recurrent? They're very morbid. We do multiple surgeries, multiple radiations, and we've shown several paper studies looking at complications, which just increase the more times you operate. But unfortunately, that's all we have. We don't have any approved medical therapies for these tumors. So we hypothesized that by investigating the epigenetic landscape of meningioma, we might identify novel mechanisms of growth and then might be able to identify therapeutic vulnerabilities, particularly for high-grade meningiomas. And multiple studies to date have looked at the epigenetic landscape, but they've been more looking at it from a classification standpoint. And what our David Raleigh and me and our lab and Abrar Chowdhury, who is a graduate student who's worked on this project, have really tried to push this to understand mechanisms that define each group and then see if we can exploit those therapeutically. So what we did is we started with a 200 sample cohort from UCSF. They were fairly well balanced considering across the grades, 87 grade one, 83 grade two, and 30 grade threes. We did DNA methylation profiling with 850K DNA methylation arrays and then RNA sequencing. We also collaborated with the University of Hong Kong and they provided us with an additional 365 samples that we performed methylation profiling on. We had robust clinical follow-up, a median follow-up of 5.6 years. And our primary pre-processing, we used the Sesame pipeline for methylation analysis. And then we did a lot of our analysis using an unbiased approach. So what did we find? These are the first two curves you're looking at here. The first curve is local freedom from recurrence. And what we see is that within the methylation profiles, we see three groups emerge, group A, B, and C. We chose to split on three. I know Felix Sam and others have proposed a six group classification, but when we do consensus matrices, you can see the most clearly defined groups is to have three groups, whereas two and going up to six do not provide such a clear definition in the outcomes. And this correlates also with overall survival, which is influenced by other things, particularly when you think the average age is 65 for meningioma patients. Interestingly, this it doesn't directly correlate, although it trends with the WHO grade. So when we look at our groupings, group C has a lot, is majority of grade two and three meningiomas, but there's others that are graded based on the WHO grade as grade one. And you can see some splits here. So we thought maybe this might explain some of the variability that we see when you see a recurrent grade one tumor that just doesn't behave like grade one, even though the histology looks that way. The first group, group A, when we began to, we looked at copy number variants and chromosomes within them. And what the first thing that we noticed is that in the group A, we call these Merlin intact because the majority of the patients in this group have NF2 neutral mutations. They don't have a loss. These, and we can show this at the protein level with some examples here, a Western blot showing Merlin is still expressed in these three examples of group A, but not in group B or C protein tumors. And these patients are the patients that have the best outcome, as I showed you earlier. So we wanted to know, summarize a number of experiments here. If you want to see in detail, we have published the preprint of this paper, but we wanted to know what Merlin is doing, what NF2 is doing to allow these patients to have a better outcome. And what we found is that Merlin is actually functioning as a tumor suppressor and limiting apoptosis. So we have a stably transfected Cas meningioma cell line, M10G. And when you treat, when they'll grow well, this is looking at annexin 5, which is a measure of apoptosis. And when you treat with the cytotoxic chemotherapy actomycin D, right here, you can see there's a big spike in apoptosis in these cells when they're transfected with a guide control RNA. But if you knock out NF2 in these Merlin intact cells, you see that all that apoptosis drops back down, even when treated with chemotherapy. So we identified a novel role where Merlin, or which is the gene product of NF2, is promoting apoptosis and may explain some of the better clinical outcomes in this group. The second group we looked at, when we started looking at the what genes were expressed and everything, we found there was a number of immune cell genes, and we did some deconvolution assays, and indeed there was a greater immune cell infiltrate, which is shown here with this CD3 immunohistochemistry. So compared to group A and group C meningiomas, these group B meningiomas have a much greater immune cell infiltrate. And when we looked at them, we actually found increased expression in genes known to be involved in the glymphatic system, which are the lymphatics of the brain, which is a new emerging field. And when we stain for PROX1, which is a gene product found in brain lymphocytes or brain lymphatic ducts, you can see these within the cell. LIVE1 also marks them, and we can see that within these immune-enriched meningiomas. In contrast, we wonder what may be recruiting these cells and what mechanisms may be working in this intermediate group. And we found that the immune-enriched group had much higher expression of HLA molecules, which may be facilitating the recruitment of these immune cells. And finally, when we looked at group three, the thing that stood out to us first was that they were hypermitotic. So looking at the MIB1 labeling index compared to the Merlin intact or the immune-enriched groups, we saw much higher MIB1 labeling. These tumors also had more expression of FOXM1, which you can see down here on the hypermitotic meningiomas. And then, we have shown in the past that FOXM1 is associated with high-grade meningioma. They also have more commonly a loss of CDKN2AB, which is an endogenous tumor suppressor of the cell cycle. So when you lose CDKN2AB, you get activation of CD6 in the cell cycle. Importantly, though, a number of these tumors retained CDKN2AB. We know that if you lose CDKN2AB, and this is going to probably be incorporated in the new WHO grading, there's a decreased overall survival. But what about these tumors where CDKN2AB in this group was retained? We noted that a lot of those tumors actually had gain of USF1. USF1 is a transcription factor on 1Q, and it has binding sites upstream of FOXM1 as well as CDK6, and through that can drive the cell cycle and drive tumor aggressiveness. We showed that if we look at CDK6 expression, which is a marker of the cell cycle and actively dividing cells, this is the baseline here. If we knock out USF1, we see decreased cell cycling. And then if we overexpress USF1, we see increased CDK6 expression. So, and those patients with USF1 gain also, 1Q gain also do much worse clinically. So we then wanted to see, could we target CDK4/6 and would that be a potential option for these tumors? When we target in cell culture, you can see four different meningioma cell lines. All of them inhibit growth at nanomolar concentrations. We then went to an organoid model system, which we had previously developed for studying meningiomas. And these are live cell imaging of human cerebral organoids in green, and then co-cultured with either grade 1 meningioma cells on this side or grade 3 meningioma cells over here. And what you can see is the grade 1 meningioma cells form these small meningioids around the surface of the organoid, but the grade 3 meningioma cells actually will go and end up invading into the organoid itself. So when we test the CDK4/6 inhibition of the cells within organoids, we see that as we have increasing dose of CDK4/6, we get decreased staining around the organoid itself. We also went into xenografts in mice, and in these, in the hypermitotic xenograft with cell line here, when we graft those into mice, they will continue to grow. But when we start treating with abaciclib, the CDK4/6 inhibitor, we see decreased growth. And that corresponds to decreased survival within the mice as well. We've just started to look at this anecdotally based on some of this using off-label use of abaciclib. So this is an example of a patient we've been treating. We now have about a half dozen on treatment at UCSF who had a grade 3 meningioma, typical high-grade meningioma course, resected, radiotherapy, the tumor progresses, she gets blind in the right eye. And then we start treating with bevacizumab to try that. It didn't really help. It was growing over to the left eye, causing problems there. We did stereotactic radiosurgery. It didn't really help. And the tumor volume kept growing. But once we started abaciclib, the volume starts declining. The patient functionally recovered. So these are anecdotal things, but it's exciting possibility for this in the future. We also can incorporate these epigenetic groups, the Merlin intact, immune enriched, and hypermitotic, into a nomogram that takes into consideration other important factors that we know in meningioma progression, including sex, treatment with radiotherapy, extent of resection, whether it's recurrent, and the labeling index. So in conclusion, we've identified three epigenetic subgroups based on different mechanisms of action. If you look at local freedom from recurrence, Merlin intact do the best, immune enriched or intermediate, and hypermitotic have the worst outcomes. And we've shown mechanistically here that if you look, the Merlin intact, in those tumors, Merlin is functioning as a tumor suppressor, promoting apoptotic pathways. The immune enriched have immune infiltration and meningeal lymphatics and are more common near the dural venous sinuses. And hypermitotic have activation of the cell cycle. And the important insights is that this can be through multiple pathways, not just CDKN2AB loss, but also gain of USF1 and probably maybe even some other mechanisms to explain some others within that group. So I think the other take home as we begin to develop trials for these is really important to not just exclude on CDKN2AB, but really identifying which meningiomas in this hypermitotic group will come through a final common pathway of cell division. So I thank David Raleigh. It's been a pleasure working in his lab, and Abrar Chowdhury, who was the graduate student who took the lead and took this project far beyond where I could have taken it in my fellowship, but I started with him. We collaborated with the Rich Lab, the Costello Lab, and all our collaborators at UCSF and our funding. So thank you very much for your time.